you.
It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Well,
everything will be
actually,
in this
room. I came to the board meeting.
Oh, yes, you're at the board meeting. Yeah.
I think we like, oh, I kept my distance. I don't know what's over there. And then you guys stayed and hung around afterwards. So, all good.
Let me get my name tag.
Yep, Kathy Brister.
Hi, Nydia.
Good morning, Kathy.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to tell me your name again.
Dana.
Dana, we met. You were at Welcome, right? Did you work
on her? I have in the past.
I don't think she did this last year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't think so.
You look familiar. I think we've met at some point.
I'm sure that you have.
Oh, the accelerator.
Yeah.
Good morning. My name is Richard Griffiths. I'm a Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member. And I'd like to welcome everybody to the 32nd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It's the third year that the conference is presented with the organizational support of the foundation. This conference was originally conceived by some judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between those justices and journalists and lawyers that don't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges they face and the state of Georgia faces. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can go to the QR code or type in the bit.ly and get the rundown. You can get the bios, and you can get the additional supplemental materials, which there's quite a bit. We will have a working lunch today, and we'll let you know when those box lunches are in, so you can go get yours before all of the vegetarian ones or the ones with extra mustard disappear. I also want to remind everybody that there will be a reception at the end of the day, a good opportunity for some networking, good opportunity to meet the organizers and tell us what we should do better for next year, and your fellow participants. My big job today is going to try to keep the trains running on time and trying to make sure we are keeping somewhat close to the schedule, particularly around lunchtime. We've got a taping with WABE, and so we need to be really precise about that time. And so if we ask you to get back to your seats, please get back to your seats. Now I want to talk about the sponsors whose contributions go so far as to support this conference. The names are now on the screen: the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, CNN, big sponsor, the State Bar of Georgia, which gives us enormous support in setting up this conference, and the space, and your parking. So thanks very much to the State Bar and to Jones Day. And you see the other many generous sponsors on that list. This conference would not have been pulled together if it was not for the tireless work of the volunteers that you see on the screen. It's a lot of volunteers. A lot of hard work goes into this conference. I want to especially thank Peter Canfield from Jones Day, who patiently guides this committee through the preparation of this event. Now we'll turn to the kickoff panel of the conference. Don't forget there's a reception at 5 o'clock with a little bit of wine for those who like that. That will be outside, so you can continue the conversation then. I'm going to turn things over now to Frank LoMonte, formerly at the Bryan Center, now of my alma mater, CNN, in the legal department there, doing amazing things.
Richard, thank you. And I'll open with my standard disclaimer that although I'm with CNN, I'm speaking on my own nickel today. This is what I wear on my day off. With that disclaimer, I want to get us back on schedule, talk quickly, and get you out of here on time. So We wish I could say that we were brilliant enough that we had scripted Lisa Raham's panel and this one to be a seamless baton pass. We're not that brilliant, but I'll take credit for being that lucky, which is that Lisa Raham perfectly set us up for the hour that we're about to spend talking about the divisive concepts laws that are sweeping the country, including here in Georgia, and other issues concerning what might be called the culture wars as they're playing out in public higher ed and K-12 schools around the country. And we have four illustriously credentialed experts to help us understand where the First Amendment does and does not apply inside of the realm of public education. I'm going to introduce each of them with a brief bio in a second, but just to sort of set the field of play for us. I think it's no surprise to any of us in this field that college campuses are places where battles about free speech and the First Amendment are very much at home. The Supreme Court told us as far back as 1972 in the Helium case that there is no room for the view that First Amendment rights apply with any diminished force on college campuses than in the community at large. Fast forward from the 70s and the Vietnam era to today, we see battles regularly over things like can a controversial political speaker appear at commencement or give a guest lecture or use a university auditorium over the objections of offended people in the audience. It might be more surprising that this controversy is now making itself felt and trickling down to the K-12 level as well. I guess most pointedly here in the South, where a number of states enacted variations of what is being called kind of colloquially anti-wokeness statutes, using the Governor DeSantis term. Here in Georgia, Senate Bill 377, the divisive concept law was enacted last session. Among its features, it directs both K-12 and higher ed institutions to refrain from espousing divisive concepts in the classroom, and it defines divisive concepts to include, just non-exclusively here, the concept that the United States or the state of Georgia are inherently or systematically racist, that meritocracy or hard work are inherently racially biased concepts, or that any person should be scapegoated on the grounds of race or ethnicity. And it also interestingly governs the courts as well. It says that no agency, including the courts, can order anyone to undergo any training that exposes them to these divisive concepts as a remedial measure. So for those of you in the judiciary, this has some spillover effect to you as well. In 2022, the Florida legislature enacted what they now call the Individual Freedom Act, their version of the Divisive Concepts Act. And just a few months ago, it was enjoined by a U.S. district judge on First Amendment grounds, finding that it was viewpoint-based, vague, and not narrowly tailored. And so that case has been teed up for 11th Circuit review, and so we will soon to be getting some guidance on where the courts believe that the authority of government begins and ends to make these curricular decisions. And so to guide us through through this morass of tricky issues, and I should say, by the way, we had Representative Will Wade, Republican from Dawsonville, who had generously agreed to come even during the session when he's busy, but just yesterday he let us know he's been called away to his district to deal with an urgent constituent matter, which is exactly what he should be doing, so we thank him for kindly agreeing to speak, and we'll miss him make do in his absence. And to help us understand, I'm just going to go alphabetically here through our list. Mack Freeman is the president-elect of the Georgia Library Association. He is the head of public services of the Georgia Tech Library and has formerly served as a branch manager with the Gwinnett County Library System. Scott McCoy is an attorney with the Southern Poverty Law Center. He works out of their South Florida office, and he's graciously make the trip to join us today. His focus and his practice is on LGBTQ rights. Formerly practiced law with the Cleary Gottlieb Law Firm in New York. Interestingly, served as a state senator in Utah prior to that experience, and also clerked for justice on the Utah Supreme Court. So he's a well-traveled man with a lot of passport stamps. Thanks for being adding Georgia to it, Scott. Yep. Ling-Ling Nie is Deputy General Counsel, Chief Compliance Officer, and Head of Government Affairs for Aura, a cybersecurity firm. But the reason we asked her here today has less to do with that and more to do with her previous service from 2019 to 2022 as Vice President and General Counsel of Georgia Tech here in Atlanta. She's had a distinguished and varied legal career that includes 5 years practicing with the U.S. Treasury Department. So thank you for joining us. And finally, Jennifer Rippner is both a JD and a PhD. She's currently a lecturer who focuses and specializes in education law with Indiana University. She previously taught at UGA's Institute for Higher Education. She has worked in the Chancellor's Office here in Georgia and as Education Policy Advisor under Governor Sonny Perdue, and is also as head of the state's Charter Schools Commission, so a person deeply steeped in the law and policy of public education. So a wonderful array of experts. And I'm going to ask Ling-Ling, if you don't mind starting us off, just sort of lay the groundwork and help us understand. I think everybody who took con law knows at least a little First Amendment law and knows about that, you know, the government can't engage in prior restraints or dictate the content of speech. But how do all those boilerplate First Amendment principles make themselves felt on the campus of a public university?
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I need to speak closely to the microphone.
Please. So
bring it closer. I'm no longer employed at Georgia Tech, so please don't attribute things I'm saying as I'm speaking on behalf of the Institute. I'm also not speaking on behalf of the university system of Georgia, which, for those of you who may not know, is the state agency that oversees all the public universities in our state. But as you mentioned, I joined Georgia Tech in 2019, having zero background in higher education law. So I remember during the first week when we were discussing sort of free speech issues, it occurred to me this was the first time since law school that I had to think about these things. Because prior to that, I was at a global technology company, and we never had free speech, First Amendment issues in the work that I did there. But fortunately, Georgia Tech has an extraordinarily talented legal team with very, very deep knowledge in this area. I'll shout out to Kathleen Gosden, who is the Chief Counsel of Student Life and Academic Affairs, and I relied very heavily on her and her team to counsel me through a lot of the issues that were emerging during my tenure. So I say that because I did my homework and I read up all of your biographies, and I am the least qualified person on this panel to speak about free speech issues and academic freedom. But nonetheless, one of the more common issues during my time there in the First Amendment or free speech realm was academic freedom. And to kind of give you a little bit of a picture on that, I mean, in our society, I would say that, you know, one of the reasons universities exist is to serve as a vehicle for the free exchange of ideas, to facilitate scholarly debate, and to help with the search for knowledge. And so academic freedom is sort of tied to that and essentially allows faculty to engage in teaching, in research, in the publication of their research, in an environment that, in an environment of free inquiry and discussion. Now there are some responsibilities, I won't call them limitations, but responsibilities that come with academic freedom. You know, you have to teach things that are accurate, things that are supported by your academic peer community. You know, the quintessential example is you can't teach that 2 + 2 = 5. You need to respect other people's viewpoints in your instruction. And there are a number of considerations and responsibilities that I know Georgia Tech takes very seriously. And if you would want specific information, I can recommend the provost's website, which contains sort of the policies and procedures related to academic freedom, relating to free speech, relating to all those issues. I know that's kept current and also reviewed and supported by the University System of Georgia, so there's alignment on all those topics. But essentially, that's kind of the landscape that I was really focused on during my time at Georgia Tech, was really the academic freedom portion. We went through a tumultuous sort of 3 years during my tenure there, and there were lots of concerned voices on campus. I'm sure we'll talk a little bit more about that, but that's sort of in a nutshell is what were the main issues I was handling.
Well, that's a great setup for us to lateral to Jennifer. And Jennifer, if you don't mind, if you could sort of specialize in the K-12 area, talked about, you know, you heard academic freedom mentioned, right? Do these sorts of concepts make the translation seamlessly to K-12, or is there a different legal framework that applies?
The short answer is no. There is a different legal framework, and no, they don't transfer seamlessly, because
going to talk in broad strokes here because we're not going, you know, into the nitty-gritty necessarily, but teachers in public K-12 schools have little to no academic freedom in their classrooms. And that is because we know education is not mentioned in the U.S. Constitution, so it's relegated to states, and so who represents the states as far as passing laws and promulgating passing laws is the legislature. And so they have a primary responsibility in making curricular decisions in K-12. Now, often they delegate that to a state board of education and or local boards of education, depending on state constitutions and state statutes. But on major issues, they do weigh in. So if you look at any title section in Georgia Title 20, there's a lot that the legislature has said about education, and usually it relates to hot topic curricular issues. To date, it's been about sex ed, but now it's about divisive concepts. But it goes back as far as compulsory attendance. The legislature weighs in on that, and maybe 10 to 20 years ago, they were hot into testing and accountability. So it isn't new that legislatures are taking up education. I think the other important point is that beyond mandating what's in the curriculum, legislatures can decide the extent of parental rights for opting their children out of certain parts of the curriculum. They can say nothing, and then that devolves to local boards of education, but parents don't automatically have any statutory or a constitutional right to say what the curriculum will be for their child in public education. I say there's all these rights, but courts do sometimes intervene, especially when legislatures are passing laws that are patently discriminatory against a protected group. And the best example of that is Brown versus Board of Education, U.S. Supreme Court. There's some other lower court opinions. They're not a lot. We have one Supreme Court case that has addressed school board's authority to remove books from a library. So I'm thinking of curricular topics. I'm thinking of putting books in a library, putting books out. One Supreme Court case about taking books out, it's the PICO case. And it was a plurality opinion, so it's not even really, not only is it confusing, but it's really not binding. But there's a couple parts of it that I want to mention. The court recognized the discretion of school boards to make decisions that reflect the legitimate and substantial community interest in promoting respect for authority and traditional values, be they social, moral, political. And even the three justices who endorsed the notion that students have a protected right to receive information under the First Amendment recognize the broad authority of schools to remove materials that are vulgar or educationally unsuitable, and we see those words in lower court opinions, so long as the procedures are regular and unbiased. So just to sum the state of the law, books can be removed for education suitability purposes, but not for viewpoint-based reasons, and dictating between the two, I know Scott is going to get into some case law, is really difficult. Curricular changes, local and state authorities have much more leeway because even in higher ed, when we talk about we don't want to inculcate students, well, in K-12, it was set up to inculcate students in democracy. And so there's that fine line of inculcation versus First Amendment rights of students. So in all of my research and thinking about this, I think policymakers would likely only be overruled by courts in their legislative actions concerning curriculum if they made overtly discriminatory, racist, bigoted remarks or motivations apparent in passing whatever they pass. All I have to say, it's a steep hill in K-12.
So that's a great conceptual framework. We have our vocabulary, but Scott, this is not conceptual to you. This is very concrete to your everyday practice, and you're out there on the front lines litigating these cases. So give us the frontline litigator's view of what's going on up there.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks for having me here. So I'm based in Florida, and of course, Florida, I think, is on the leading edge of a lot of this, and states like Georgia and Alabama and Mississippi and others across the country are copycatting what is happening in Florida. Last year in the Florida legislature, Florida passed a couple of bills that are of note and that are being litigated that was referenced. So the first one was called the Stop Woke Act. That was literally its first envisioned title. And that bill focused on three areas. One was K through 12, one was higher education, and the third was actual, like, in private business settings. And the bill was designed to essentially curb or quash critical race theory and DEI sensitivity training, if you will, is how it's pejoratively, you know, characterized often, in all three of those settings. To show you kind of the continuum of protections in the law, the part about private businesses has been enjoined in a federal lawsuit. The part about higher ed has been enjoined in a federal lawsuit. But no lawsuit has yet been brought with respect to K-12. And I think that goes to what Jennifer just described. The reason that is because there is much more deference given. And the standard is steeper in the K-12 setting. That's not to say that there aren't protections. I mean, there's a Supreme Court case that says that, you know, students don't check their First Amendment rights at the school door. So you have to figure out, like, how to use what standards and things there are in existence to challenge in the K-12 setting. Now, there's another law that was passed, which is referred to by its opponents as the Don't Say Gay and Trans Law. And it's referred to by its proponents as the Parental Rights in Education Law. So you can see the different frames that the sides are picking in order to communicate about these different things. That law essentially put a prohibition in place in K-12. K-3, you're not allowed to have instruction about sexual orientation or gender identity at all. And then in the other grades, from 4-12, it has to be age appropriate or developmentally appropriate, whatever that means. And we actually, the Southern Poverty Law Center, is part of a lawsuit that is challenging that particular law in Florida. And we are relying on the PICO decision. That's the First Amendment right to receive different information, which is kind of the flip side of the right to speak in the First Amendment. We're also challenging it under the First Amendment case law about viewpoint and content restriction. And I think it's important, you're right, because there is some leeway, but if you look at the motivations for that particular law, it really, the motivation is, and this is what we argue, is based on really moral disapproval and not a legitimate pedagogical rationale that underlies it. Because let's face it, there is no sexual education in K-3 in any Florida school anywhere, nor has there ever been. What's being possibly taught is that some families have two parents that are different sex, some families have parents that are the same sex. And unfortunately, the law is written broadly enough and vaguely enough that there's an exercise in Florida curriculum for kindergarten that where you draw your family tree and you color it. And in the state sunshine standards for that grade, part of what you're supposed to be teaching to kids is how they fit into their families, right? And so that family tree exercise is meant to do that. But the problem is if that's instruction and you have a family, and one of our set of our plaintiffs is two gay men who have two kids in these grades, you know, what happens when they fill out their family tree and color it, and it sparks a discussion and questions about an unorthodox family structure, right? And so they've already chilled their speech, and they've already started. So in the First Amendment context, you know, that's all you need. If the law has this chilling effect, you have standing to at least go and try and challenge it, and that's what we're doing in that particular case. That case is called Cousins et al. Versus the Orange County School Board. We sued four school boards, and then the State Board of Education as well, because that law also empowers the State Board of Education then to develop the standards and rules for the 4th grade through 12th grade in terms of developmentally and age appropriate, and that kind of thing. One other really unique thing that is challenging about the Florida Don't Say Gay and Trans law is its enforcement mechanism. And the enforcement mechanism is essentially any parent that doesn't like what is being taught in terms of these subjects, sexual orientation or gender identity, in their school has the right to bring a private right of action, sue the school, and recover attorney's fees and costs if they're successful. But there's no corollary that the school board gets costs and fees if they're successful. So basically what that creates is, it creates, the person who gets to set the standard for what those words mean, instruction, sexual orientation, gender identity, is the most conservative, angry parent who brings a lawsuit against a school board. And that makes it, like, in a First Amendment sense, right, if there is arbitrary or unknown enforcement and interpretation of a possible law, then you get into void for vagueness and overbreadth issues, and that's another issue that we're raising. So it's a very confusing and tricky enforcement mechanism that they decided to implement. So anyway, that's kind of where we are in the front lines. Obviously, these are happening in Georgia, like divisive concepts. I mean, talking about vague, right? There are some, I think, parents who are flat earthers who might think that teaching that the world is round is a divisive concept, right? Because there are opinions on both sides. So, like, where do we draw these lines? Do we go back to heliocentrism, you know, for 1,000 years? That was the settled concept, and now, is that a divisive concept? So there is much danger here in terms of educating our students about what are fairly well-accepted consensus concepts, like the idea that people have different sexual orientations and marriage equality. I mean, these are things that 70% of the population understands and agrees with. So how is this a divisive concept, and why are we letting a minority like define these out of existence in our schools? These are things that we need to be asking, and these are the reasons why we're bringing lawsuits to try to challenge these and clarify these. I mean, the most important thing is if you're gonna do curriculum legislation, then do what you mean to do, right? If you don't want your K through third graders to be taught human sexuality or about sexual acts, then say that. Don't say sexual orientation or gender identity and instruction, which is vague, and it sweeps in way more than you supposedly say you're intending to sweep in. Because then you get into the place where you're marginalizing huge parts of your school body and your society, and that's not necessary. You can accomplish that by just doing what you really mean. But the truth is, they chose sexual orientation, they chose gender identity very purposefully. They knew what they were doing.
Thanks. I want to turn to Mack Freeman. Mack, you are where the rubber hits the road here, a practicing librarian, and if you were drawing up a stereotype for a tranquil and stress-free profession to go into, I think library sciences would be right at the top of that list. And so is this a tranquil and stress-free profession for you today, Mack Freeman? What is it like being a librarian in the current legal and political climate?
So I had even pushed back that it wasn't tranquil. That mistaken notion that you have is all from TV. That's never been true. So we've been slowly shredding the social safety net in this country for basically my entire life. And public libraries have basically been picking up a lot of that gap along the way. So that's where people go to apply for jobs, that's where homeless people go during the day, so anything that's going on up to and including giving Narcan injections to people overdosing in urban libraries, that stuff's happening. If you think this is peaceful work, you are grossly mistaken. Also, if you think that libraries are dying, that's grossly mistaken as well. Every public library system in this state has between 20 and 50% of its population with a library card. Okay, they are getting hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of visits a year across this state. They're still heavily in use. And that's not even including our K-12 and our higher education institutions. COVID was incredibly hard. It was traumatizing. I went home the third week of March, and I was back in the library the second week of May. We were open to the public 10 days later. If you think that people have recovered from that, they haven't. We have an entire crop of second graders right now who have never been taught to read in person. This is their first full school year back. you think that media specialists aren't dealing with that? That that's not enough trauma and work all on its own that they need to do? And now they have this entire ecosystem that nobody understands. We don't come from a law background. We don't know what this is. So first of all, people don't have any knowledge of their professional and personal rights, as it is. They're just trying to go to work and help people. But the landscape keeps shifting so much that people don't know what they're supposed to do. And this work was so complicated before. Every library is gonna have something in it that offends somebody's sensibilities, because people have all sorts of wacky sensibilities. But I can tell you from my experience in seeing what actually gets challenged, what actually gets censored, is stuff from Black, Brown, and Queer voices. That's where it really comes down to. It might have some sort of broader or more overarching appeal, but that's where it is. And this landscape is more complex than it looks like at front. So when we talk about libraries, we're talking about instructional material that's actually used as part of class. We're talking about classroom libraries that teachers generally provide for themselves. The media center, which sometimes has a media specialist in it, but due to budget cuts, sometimes doesn't, especially in more rural counties. Then public libraries, and they all have different funding sources and different authority levels and different audiences and different things they're trying to do. You know, I meant to say this at all, I'm speaking on behalf of myself, you know, and the dozens, if not hundreds, of library people that I've spoken to over the last year. But I gotta say that, like, when the rubber hits the road, people have to make these decisions as professionals. Your professionals aren't gonna protect these concepts for you because they don't have the power to. The same person that they're going to for their budget is the same person telling them they can't do these things. So they won't. My mortgage is due on the first, just like everybody else's is. And I'm in a better position to absorb a hit than most people are. And so they don't. They decide that I will try to work my way around this, or I won't do this, and I'll try to do the good that I can. But I have heard stories of people being threatened. I have heard stories of people losing their jobs. I have heard stories of funding being withheld until certain things are done or not done. And, you know, I'm a part of a different professional association that has an anti-doxing kit ready to go, because that just happens now. And so what are you gonna do when your workplace isn't there to back you up? This wasn't work we had to do 3 years ago. This is not something I was taught in grad school 10 years ago. And, you know, we're trying to do our best. We're trying to do this work. We are trying to be there for everybody, but we can't, because we're limited and there's only so much that we can do. And like I said, this work was hard before, and it's only getting harder every single year.
Thank you for that. Jennifer, I saw you making copious notes during Scott's presentation, so before I throw it open to questions, I just wanted to see, did you have any points that you wanted to elaborate or respond on before we throw it open?
No, I was just making notes of things I want to go back and look at, and I also invite Scott to talk to our students at Indiana University, I was learning a lot as well.
I do have a note about a question. Did you want to step up and ask it?
Yes, I'd be happy to.
That's your cue, Richard.
My cue. You know, we talk a little bit about the changes in our society and wokeness run amok, and I'm thinking about the rewrites of Roald Dahl, where all of a sudden fat is no longer allowed, and where the witch who was hiding among the human population by working as a cashier instead becomes a scientist in the rewrites. Are we losing a piece of our history and context? Are we leaving out the way in our society to put those historical novels in some kind of context? And by rewriting them, are we crossing a line at some point? I'm trying to channel Representative Wade here a little bit to see if I can get a bit more understanding of why these changes are necessary, and how does that bridge across to the many other things you've been talking about?
Go ahead, Mack, you can start.
So I mean, the biggest thing is context takes time. And if you're teaching to a standardized test every year, there's no time to teach context. But the idea that you can teach the history of American or Western literature and not talk about divisive concepts is ridiculous. To not cover queer subjects and talking about Herman Melville is not true. You know, there are so many great 19th century American novels that are about affairs and sex and so many things. And so I think that there's all that, and you can put them in historical context, but does that need to be taught to a slightly, you know, older audience? Like, there's a book I think about all the time, one of the Madeline books is called Madeline and the Gypsies. It's like, that's not a great word, we don't really use that word anymore. Should we take it out? They have, the publisher hasn't taken it out of circulation. Is that context that the 3 to 4 year old audience that is the target for this book can understand? Probably not. So, you know, I think that's part of our responsibility as educators is to help make those choices, all that. And that's, you know, something that also kind of personally galls me about some of these bills is like the idea that somebody wasn't keeping their eye on the ball and making sure that things were developmentally appropriate and appropriate to curriculum before that. That's what we do all day. That's the job. And so that, I think that that's all part of it. And, you know, some stuff is being rewritten, but some stuff people are taking out of circulation on their own. You know, there was a big kerfuffle 2 years ago about like 5 Dr. Seuss books being taken out of circulation. The publisher did that. Nobody complained or anything. They just went through their old works and were like, you know what? We don't think we can stand beside these anymore. So we're not going to tell you to censor them. We're not going to take them off the shelf. We're just not going to sell them anymore, as is our right, as the person who owns it in this marketplace. So I think that that's my personal approach to that.
But copies are still in libraries.
Oh yeah, copies are still in libraries. They're still there. And like, and we, and that's the thing, libraries don't think about this in as one giant monolith as it is, because I certainly have people even further to the left than me who, you know, challenge the whole concept of neutrality in libraries. You know, are we creating an unsafe space for people by having certain thoughts within this, these walls? And then there's that traditional classical liberal point of view that libraries and this sort of independent pursuit of knowledge is neutral and has to have something there for everybody and has to have that because it's the only way you can make up your mind. And to me, that's kind of what this intellectual freedom boils down to, is if we're trying to create people who are going to exist in a democracy, you have to be able to have access to the information that you need to make up your own mind. And if all you can have is the pre-approved windows and viewpoints that are there, that gets challenging and that gets problematic. It's also, books are not where kids are getting their information. Would anybody in the audience like to yell out what the number one search engine is for students under the age of 16?
TikTok
is the number one search engine for the upcoming generation of Americans. If that doesn't alarm you on its face as a subject of democratic information, I don't know what to tell you.
Let me maybe build a little bit on the question that Richard started with, and I'm going to start this with Ling-Ling, but Jennifer and others feel free to jump in. I think one of the things that Richard was maybe alluding to or pointing toward is that the pressure to censor used to predictably be sort of a left-right thing back in the Halcyon days. We knew where free speech cleaved. I mentioned the Healy case in the 70s. That was about Students for Democratic Society, a left-wing group trying to get official recognition by its university. And so we knew that the free speechers were on the left and the censors were on the right. But these are tougher, trickier times, right? And on college campuses, there are certainly pressures, countervailing pressures from both left and right to restrict speech. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about sort of experiencing and navigating some of those countervailing pressures.
Yeah, and I think those pressures have existed for quite some time, just become more pronounced in recent years. But, you know, they come in from different sources. I mean, obviously, we've had some, you know, elected officials exerting pressure on higher education institutions on what we're teaching, what we're not teaching. But it has come also from donors who threaten to, you know, withhold or cancel their sort of charitable contributions because they don't agree with the curriculum. It also comes from board members who, in many cases, have the power to approve financing and they can withhold, you know, their approval of that as well. And then, interestingly, students and parents. There's a kind of fascinating like change in that dynamic because one of the larger issues I think that higher education institutions are facing is what is the value of a college degree anymore? You know, a lot of people are choosing not to go. A lot of people are choosing to go to schools that are much more affordable because they just don't believe that they should come out of, you know, school hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. So there's almost a shift in some ways with universities viewing students as like a customer or consumer. And so when they express concern about things being taught, there's a pressure to meet their demands or to address them and respond in a way that didn't exist previously. So there are several places where this pressure has come from.
Did you also want to weigh in on that?
Just briefly. My professional career has been mostly in Georgia, but I teach at Indiana University because of their big educational law program. And so working now with the state of Indiana kind of mirrors Georgia politically in some broad strokes. And they passed a law for higher ed institutions to give training to faculty and staff on student speech rights. And I am working with the general counsel's office now, and probably should talk to Ling-Ling about this, about creating that training. And the general counsel's office is really trying to manage this competing pressures, responding to the legislature and the governor who passed the bill, but staying faithful to what the existing law is. And then there's a third component of what we know really is happening, and it goes to what Ling-Ling talked about first on academic freedom, about there are some faculty who don't assume the responsibility of academic freedom, probably like they should, and what is just good pedagogy. The example when I was working in state government here in Georgia, I talked about that kicked off a lot of the divisive concepts rhetoric was a professor at a public college here in Georgia requiring white students to write a paper on how their white privilege benefited them. And we don't know the pedagogy around that, but there's probably a way that the professor could have gotten to the same point or taught a concept maybe a little bit differently. So yes, there's the competing pressures, but then it's looking deeper into the academic freedom and talking about responsibility, not only to be an expert, but to also use good pedagogy and the concepts that you're trying to teach.
Scott, for the litigators in the audience here, I'm kind of curious to hear you elaborate a little bit on when I hear about a topic like challenging laws that restrict the books that school libraries could carry, I am seeing a panoply of potential plaintiffs here, right? I am seeing that there could be First Amendment interests that reside in the educator, the school employee. There could be First Amendment rights that reside in the student as the recipient of the information. There could be even First Amendment rights that reside in the author or the publisher. Can you sort of unbundle that and strategically, how does one bring one of those claims?
Yeah, no, actually, you hit on a very crucial and actually a very difficult subject matter, because in our lawsuit in Florida, the four school districts have moved to dismiss our case for lack of standing on behalf of all of our plaintiffs, and then the state AG is defending the state Board of Education individuals. And they're also moving. So we're having a huge standing fight right now over, you know, whose rights are at play. We actually didn't bring a claim on behalf of a teacher because there is some doubt whether or not teachers have a right to teach something in the K-12 space. I think in the higher ed space, there's a better case to be made. And actually one of the plaintiffs in the case that challenged the Stop Woke Act provisions in higher ed, one of the plaintiffs is a teacher. So, but again, you know, in the First Amendment, it really comes down to the standing comes from, you know, the self-censorship that happens as a result of whatever the particular law is. And our plaintiffs, you know, have engaged in that self-censorship for fear of, the recriminations from the enforcement, from being, some of them are students from being punished, some of them are parents from participating in, parents come in and teach, or they go as chaperones on field trips and things like that. And so that self-censorship from the law is what confers standing, or is the hook to get standing in this particular context. But it's a point of obvious, very much like a huge clash and a huge issue that likely will have to be resolved by the 11th Circuit, because there's a companion case that was brought by Equality Florida and was filed in the Northern District of Florida. We're in the Middle District of Florida, and Judge Windsor just recently dismissed the Northern District case on standing grounds. So I imagine I wouldn't be surprised if our judge in the Middle District doesn't do something similar, which means up we go to the 11th Circuit. So, one thing I just wanted to comment about where these are coming from. So I think in the LGBTQ space, what we're seeing is a backlash, right? This is a backlash from the growing acceptance of LGB, I think more so. The trans rights is very hot button and is newer than the LGB, lesbian, gay, bisexual rights, because it's more accepted. It's, you know, there's the, you know, Obergefell, you know, marriage equality rights. But then you had the Bostock decision, you know, from here in Georgia that said Title VII sex discrimination covers sexual orientation and gender identity. And some other cases, the Gavin Grimm case of the Fourth Circuit about school bathroom use for transgender individuals. There have been these advances, and I think there are cultural advances in terms of acceptance for LGBTQ people. And the sponsor of the Don't Say Gay law in Florida, one of his motivations that he said out loud at the committee hearings was, it seems like there's this explosion of kids coming out as LGBTQ. And as if talking about it in schools is why they're coming out and discovering, you know, different sexual orientations or gender identities. And so unfortunately, it's all premised on a worldview or moral belief that you choose to be LGBTQ, right? That if a student learns that a family can have two dads, well, then they might choose that for themselves, right? Unfortunately, that's not how it works, but there's not an appreciation because of the worldview held by the people pushing these laws that that's not how human sexuality works. But in reality, we know that these things are normal variations of human sexuality, and people don't choose to do these things. And so kids learning about them will not increase the chance of them being LGBTQ one bit, but they don't understand that, and that's why they're trying to clamp down the discussion. Because they clamp down the discussion, then maybe our kids won't be gay and lesbian.
We have 5 or 6 minutes left, and I want to make sure that anybody who has a question steps up to the mic to ask it. Oh, there we go, right? Yeah, please do.
I have a library question, actually. Hey. So it's my understanding in library science now that librarians are no longer generally faculty members. So they don't have tenure, they maybe don't have protections, offer their thoughts on some of this stuff, and moreover, they may not have a place at the table when some of these decisions are made. I don't know if that's the case, but you feel like that's what's happening, and is that the right direction?
So, and it's once again, like, you know, it's kind of like painting broad libraries with a broad brush. So in higher ed, even in USG, there are some USG institutions, the libraries are faculty, some of them are staff among the faculty librarians, some of them are tenure track, some of them are academic faculty. It just kind of varies place by place. In K-12, there was never any sort of protection like that, nor in public libraries. And so, you know, kind of being a seat at the table, you know, we're talking about some like very big, you know, state and national based issues up here, but like the fight of this is all very local. So like any individual librarian's like, well, what's their relationship like with their principal? That's gonna be the number one question that determines how much defense and air they've got for these topics. You know, what's the relationship between the library director and the county commission? Because, you know, they're always one budget cycle away from not existing. There's no right to a library inside of a school inside of a K-12 school or a public library, and it's only by the grace of the accrediting agencies for higher ed that libraries are required to exist. So, you know, these kind of set the broad standard and rules, but these fight on individual things happen all the time. It's how much air do you want to give it, and it's not like these people who are running these things have a lot of time as it is, and so they just want the library to go away and just be quiet, so just do whatever will make the quiet happen.
We have a question over here, please.
Hi, Lindsay from the UJ First Amendment Clinic. So my question is about how you garner public support for, lack of book bans. So in Georgia, specifically the new law that was passed for the complaint resolution policy, the only people that can make complaints are parents or guardians of the students who are attending the school. And so obviously being from the First Amendment Clinic, we are pro books being in libraries, but I'm wondering how you garner support from parents who may think that they have you know, sort of a right to be involved in their children's educational process, or have a right to sort of curtail the types of literature that their students are reading.
I'm all for parental involvement in those things, absolutely. And you know, in terms of like garnering, you know, we didn't have to do much at all in order to find plaintiffs. I mean, people came and beat down our door, and they were parents who were concerned that, you know, important books to them were being pulled out of their libraries, their school libraries. Even though the law in Florida talks about instruction, and even though the state has maintained that instruction does not include library books, every school district in the state of Florida has gone through and cleansed their classroom libraries, their school libraries, of anything that is LGBTQ related. So, you know, I think the majority of parents, you know, seem to be having a problem with this, and they have created coalitions, and they have activated themselves because they believe in their schools, and they believe in the value of having these materials available. And so, you know, in terms of garnering public support, we didn't have to do much at all, because I think there's an inherent, like, you know, belief in our society that actually libraries should defer to, or have, you know, err on the side of inclusion rather than exclusion. And you know, nobody has a, at least my, I don't think, has a very, you know, when you hear book burning or book banning, that's not a good thing. Like, when your society is going down that road, you're usually headed to a very dark place. And so that seems to be the sense in the communities that we're in, and that it's mostly a vocal minority who are trying to pull out particular, you know, books and things. I absolutely agree that there should be standards and there should be a reasonable process, but we can't let, you know, a vocal minority be the one that's dictating and running the show.
Thanks. I'm just going to, while we wait and see if another question comes up, for anybody that's interested in doing some more homework on this, for anyone who wants to see how one of these cases might play out, we got sort of a preview of it in Arizona back in the, about a decade ago. Arizona enacted a law outlawing Mexican-American studies in public schools. And in a case called Gonzalez v. Douglas, a district court in Arizona, it's a 2017 case, Gonzalez v. Douglas, district court in Arizona, to Scott's point about who holds the right here, recognized that while K-12 teachers didn't necessarily have a First Amendment interest in choosing any particular curriculum, that students did. And while, to Jennifer's point, students didn't have a constitutionally based right, it's not ensconced in the Bill of Rights to have a public education, what they did have was a right not to have a public education that was tainted by political and ideological bias, and that was the right under which they traveled. And under the district court's view, and there's a very helpful record filled with politically biased statements about Mexican-American studies in public schools, under district court's view, that violated the constitutional right to receive information, which is a First Amendment right that's not nearly so well developed as the First Amendment right to speak. The Supreme Court has told us there's a First Amendment right to receive information, but they never told us where it begins and ends. So the Gonzalez v. Douglas case, to me, is sort of a sneak preview of ones that we'll be seeing around the country. Not seeing another question, but having a couple of minutes, and just a couple of minutes, Ling-Ling and Jennifer, could you just briefly elaborate on, because you both referenced academic freedom, and I want to help the audience understand, is academic freedom a concept that has any weight in the legal setting, or is it more of sort of a, I think of it like the Force in Star Wars, it's the invisible religion that binds the universe together. Does it carry any weight in a legal analysis?
So when I teach this concept, what I have, what is it called, a Venn diagram, these two circles, First Amendment and academic freedom. First Amendment rights are there. Academic freedom is very nebulous. You have a lot of mention of it in Supreme Court cases, but is it a hard and fast right? And Frank, you probably could speak to this too, given your research and writing on the First Amendment. It's nebulous. It's also a professional norm. So beyond a legal construct, it's a professional norm. The American Association of University professors, I think I'm getting that right, has had academic freedom principles as far back as 1915. Right now, we usually work from the 1940 one, but if you actually take the time to read it, it's, you know, we tend to think AAUP is a far leftist institution, and I try to stay out of the political and just focus on the law, although I know they're intertwined. But if you look at that statement, it actually, like Ling-Ling says, gives responsibility to academics not to abuse their freedom in disseminating information. So I guess the short answer is kind of. Kind of a legal concept, but also a professional norm.
Uncertainty is a perfect place for us to leave this panel. And so with thanks to our speakers, we will take a short break and invite you back for our 3 o'clock. Thank you so much, Ben.
What a fantastic day. A few items before we head to the reception. I want to again thank our sponsors. In particular, again, I want to thank the bar who make this space available to us, who give us so much support through the year. And again, for that fabulous parking. When you have the opportunity on your way out, please thank them. I also want to thank the planning committee members that have worked so hard to pull this event together. And there's one name at the top of the list there I want to thank. It's written in small type, so I've blown it up just a little bit. Peter Canfield is our planning committee chair. The first conference was in 1989. We skipped a couple of years, one very early, and then one after 9/11. But guiding this effort through the last 30 years, 30 conferences, has been Peter Canfield. Love, corralling plenty of type A lawyers, judges, and journalists, getting them on a committee, getting them to work together towards a program that educates, informs, and challenges. We owe Peter a huge debt of gratitude. Please step up here for a moment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go get a drink.
It's great to see you.
I will